tell us.
This is a kind of condensation of a 600-page book, but it's also what I want to give you is a historical view of where the trouble started in Western civilization and take you through what happened up to the present time, roughly. So I have to read because I have such a short-term memory that even a few minutes it might disappear. So I think that we exist on this beautiful blue planet in the midst of a cosmos of mind-blowing immensity and extraordinary beauty. But what might be its dream? Through the infinitesimal spark of cosmic light that is our human consciousness, the universe is revealing to us the complexity and splendor of its evolutionary journey. It's been telling us its story through our consciousness. We are now aware of our evolutionary history and our origins in the cosmos, but we've apparently forgotten that the universe has an inner life as well as a material form, and that this inner life or soul is the eternal ground of our own consciousness. So my talk will explore why the concept of the soul was lost and how it is returning now, possibly through the psychedelic issues that we've heard about. I believe that what we call mind and consciousness is only a tiny part of a greater life to which we belong and which lives through us. I've had three mentors in my life. The first was Sri Ramana, who set me on the path of a quest to answer the question, who am I? The second was St. Francis, who taught me to respect nature. And the third was Jung, who taught me that consciousness can evolve further if a bridge can be built between the conscious mind and the fathomless depths of the soul and the ultimate knower within it that he identified with the word self. My life work has been to bring together the spiritual teachings of the East with those of the West and to recover the neglected feminine archetype for our very unbalanced culture. For countless thousands of years, ancient people had a sense of connection with an invisible dimension of reality. There was a ladder connecting earth and heaven. And we've kicked away the ladder and have lost this sense of connection. Because of this, I think that as a species, we are now radically out of balance, way off course. We've forgotten that we are called to a higher destiny and a different goal. Today, we seem to be stuck between a rock and a hard place, the rock of a belief in a remote creator God conceived as the external cause of the manifest world, and the hard place of the belief promoted by reductionist science that we inhabit a universe that is without consciousness, meaning, or purpose. Can we find a way, perhaps, to move beyond both belief systems, seeing them as reflecting a stage or phase in the evolution of consciousness, but now in need of being relinquished as new elements emerge and become accessible to our understanding? I think we can if we explore our mythological history and see how some of the beliefs it has engendered are responsible for what David Boehm described as the fragmented way we think and for our present limited concepts of mind and consciousness. So now I want to go back into history and to just mention four, what I think are four main phases of belief. First of all, in what I call the lunar era, because the moon was the main luminary at that time, the era of the Great Mother of the Paleolithic and Neolithic era. Spirit at this time is both transcendent and immanent within every aspect of the phenomenal world. The visible and invisible worlds are closely connected, as they still are in shamanic cultures today. Secondly, the Bronze Age, and later, the worship of many goddesses and gods who personified the archetypal powers of the invisible world and who are worshipped in India to this day. Thirdly, what I call the solar era, because the sun became the focus of consciousness then, and the Iron Age, and the great father god of the three patriarchal religions, which saw the separation of spirit and nature, creator and creation. Spirit becomes wholly transcendent and divine immanence is lost. And lastly, the present secular age of scientific rationalism, where spirit does not exist and there is no transcendent dimension of reality. So first I want to look at the lunar era, the phase of the Great Mother. The image of the Great Mother is at least 25,000 years old. In fact, a new statue has been discovered in Germany that's 40,000 years old. Once upon a time, the starry cosmos was imagined as a Great Mother, from whose womb all life emerged. Nature was experienced as a theophany, although of course that word wasn't used then, and the whole cosmos was a living being. The origin of the concept of the soul as a feminine matrix, womb, or web of life was the Great Mother, in my view. First of all, the Paleolithic and Neolithic Great Mother, and later in the Bronze Age, goddesses like Isis in Egypt and the great goddess Artemis of Ephesus, who's shown here in the middle. The blackness of Artemis was transmitted to the image of the Black Madonna in Europe, which kept alive the ancient relationship between the Great Mother and nature, soul, and cosmos. Those three things, nature, soul, and cosmos, is what she personified. The mythology throughout this time was focused on the moon and an eternal process of birth, growth, death, and regeneration. There was no conflict between time and eternity. There was no polarization because the moon was both the eternal and the recurrent stages going through time, so to speak. So there was a unity. I think Plato said, time is the living image of eternity. So for some 25,000 years, the Great Mother and these great goddesses personified the principle of relationship, the interconnectedness and interdependence of every aspect of life, and above all, the sacredness of life. This is something we've utterly lost. This feeling was still present at the time of the pre-Socratic Greeks, when the philosopher Thales of Miletus exclaimed, "The all is alive." And it survived in Plato's concept of the soul of all, which he described as a single living creature that encompasses all the living creatures that are within it. Plato's concept was transmitted, as you know, to Plotinus and to his concept of the anima mundi, or soul of the world. But now we come to a huge change, and that began around 2000 BC, and it began in the area of Iraq and the Middle and Near East. We enter what I call the solar era, the phase of separation, an era of huge cultural change. And the sun, rather than the moon, becomes the primary celestial body and is quite a different mythology connected with the sun than there is with the moon. The image of deity changes from Great Mother to Great Father. Divine immanence is lost. The emphasis is on the transcendence of spirit. In the myth of the fall of man, Earth becomes a place of exile and punishment for primordial sin. Man is given dominion over the Earth, but he is no longer part of the divine order. He lives in a world contaminated by the fall and subject to sin, suffering, and death. This myth was taken literally and caused enormous suffering because of that. Now, the mythic theme of this era, from around 2000 BC, is the battle between light and darkness, good and evil, which has led ultimately to the battle to conquer and subdue nature in the service of man. And it's reflected in this image of the hero killing the dragon. And this solar mythology, together with the hero myth, worked its way into Babylonian, Persian, Greek, and patriarchal mythologies. The image of the hero slaying the dragon became a template for man's subjugation of nature and his tribal enemies, and it survives today in the battle against the axis of evil. During the 4,000 years of the solar era, war became endemic, promoted by warrior leaders intent on power, territorial conquest, and the creation of huge empires. Set in the context of the psyche, however, this battle can be seen to represent the ego's struggle for autonomy in relation to the immense controlling power of the matrix of instinct from which it was emerging, and which is symbolized here by the dragon. I'd like you to take me up afterwards about this because it needs further explanation. So we have instinct at the base, we have nature in the beginning, then instinct, then we have the slow emergence of the conscious ego from that matrix of instinct, but still controlled by it very much. And this was a tremendous struggle, and it was symbolized, this matrix was symbolized by the dragon. So all the mythology of this time is about the fight with the dragon. But we have to ask, what were the effects of this tremendous archetypal shift of emphasis from lunar to solar mythology, and from creator as mother to creator as father? Why did it occur? I think it occurred because at this stage in the evolution of consciousness, the fragile ego needed the support of the masculine archetype to help it to emerge from the feminine matrix of instinct, to strengthen and focus it, and to develop what we call our conscious mind. Hence, it identified itself with a male image of deity. However, the elimination of the image of the Great Mother has had profound effects on the formation of the Western psyche and the balance of Western civilization. As God moved further and further away from his creation, so the earth, nature, and matter, once identified with the Great Mother, lost the sacredness which had been associated with the immanence of the divine in the phenomenal world. Only the mystical traditions of Kabbalah and alchemy kept it alive in the West, and only in these two traditions is there relationship and union between the two principal archetypal, between the two archetypal principles and the two aspects of the Godhead. The Virgin Mary doesn't count as an aspect of the Godhead. So that those two traditions are the only one which kept that marriage, as it were, alive. The patriarchal religions put the emphasis of their teaching on collective belief, obedience to and worship of God, rather than, as in the Eastern traditions, on the transformation of consciousness. They drove a wedge between spiritual life and earthly life and split the human organism into two parts, mind and body, controller and controlled, a concept that was transmitted to both science and medicine. Gender roles became fixed. Man was a creative mind. Woman was fertile womb. Spirit and nature, mind and body, became fixed in opposition to each other. And in a warrior culture, soul and the instinctive feeling values associated with it were overridden and ignored. Their survival depended largely on the artist and the poet, and the musician and the mystic, but woman's voice was utterly silenced. So to sum up, something that's really lasted until the present day, these were the effects of this polarizing solar mythology. The feminine archetype associated with nature, soul, body, and matter was split off from spirit. Those four elements of the feminine were split off from spirit. Thinking was dissociated from feeling, and mind from soul. Nature and the earth were no longer sacred, and nature was effectively de-souled. Man was identified with spirit, and woman was identified with nature. Woman became subject to man, giving rise to the misogyny that still afflicts us today. Body was split off from mind, and mind from soul. If you look at all the religious traditions, you need to be aware of how the body was treated by them, and even today, how it's treated by them. Sexuality, mainly through St. Augustine's doctrine of original sin, was viewed as transmitting the sin of the fall. So every time one had intercourse with one's wife or husband, one was transmitting the sin. That's a dreadful doctrine. Can you imagine what it did to the sex life of men and women for hundreds and hundreds of years, from 400 AD until practically the present time? Anyway, St. Augustine is not my favorite Christian saint. So, all of this split, I've covered a very large area here, from 2000 BC, the actual myth of the fall came in around 800 BC. But all this is carried in the mythology of the fall of man and in this image of the expulsion from the Garden of Eden. And I think, to put it mildly, that this myth has had a very negative effect on the human psyche and on Western civilization. And in reference to the lack of bliss, this is where it comes from. Nobody was allowed to have any blissful feelings. So the change which it reflects and promotes tore us out of nature, symbolized by the Garden of Eden, and led to the pathological symptoms resulting from a profound experience of dissociation, separation, and loss, symptoms similar to those that a child exhibits when it has lost its mother. We can understand now that the emergence of the conscious mind or ego from the matrix of instinct was a vital evolutionary achievement, but it was won at the expense of the loss of the former profound instinctive sense of relationship with the earth and cosmos. And I stress the word instinct there. So, the end result of this is that we carry within us two kinds of consciousness, two ways of knowing. The first is lunar and is associated, in my view, with the soul. And it can be defined as the matrix of consciousness, a very ancient, instinctive, participatory, relational way of knowing, mediated through instinct, intuition, feeling, and the right hemisphere of the brain, I believe, and originating long before 2000 BC, but still alive in shamanic cultures today. The second is solar, associated with the mind, as we know it now, a goal-focused, objective way of knowing, mediated through linear thinking, the mind and the left hemisphere of the brain. And it came into provenance, as I said, from around 2000 BC, and has lasted and been developed until the present time. So, a radical imbalance developed in the Western psyche as the solar way of knowing was superimposed on the older lunar way. The left hemisphere became dominant, linear thinking became dominant, and we lost all awareness of the sacredness of the life of the earth and the cosmos and the sense of our profound relationship with them. Maybe if I'd taken LSD, I could have got here quicker without having to write a book that took me 20 years. And if you don't know the book, The Master and His Emissary, The Divided Brain and the Making of the Western World, where he explains all this in the greatest detail, and absolutely fascinating, he's a psychiatrist, I would recommend that you all read it, because I think you would be bowled over by it. So this imbalance within the psyche was reflected in the customs and beliefs of different societies. And because of it, patriarchal civilization developed an unbalanced and overwhelmingly masculine character. Within the psyche, the conscious ego identified with the hero became increasingly separated from the matrix of the instinctual soul out of which it had evolved. As time went on, it became more and more inflated and omnipotent until its detachment was complete and it no longer had any relationship with the matrix from which it had emerged. If you ask people what the soul is today, they haven't the slightest idea of what it might convey to them. They usually touch their hearts, but that's as far as it goes. This painting is by Blake, by the way. When science broke away from the stifling control of the Catholic Church in the 16th century, it developed on the foundation of this dissociation between spirit and nature. Because by eradicating all vestiges of paganism and animism, Christian theology had banished the idea of spirit being present in nature and matter. 400 years ago, there was a fundamental shift of focus from religion to science, a shift of focus from faith to knowledge, from confinement within a rigid and persecuting orthodoxy to a passionate exploration of the physical universe and the significance of the individual. As science benefited from Newton's incredible discoveries, it began to forge a path to the astounding discoveries that have revealed not only the process of evolution on Earth, but also the process of evolution in the universe. However, with the growing emphasis on the rational mind, it was easy for science to get rid of both God and the soul, since their existence could not be proven through the methodologies and instruments it had developed. That is really a category error, but I can't go into that now. Neither religion nor science embraced the idea of the further potential development of human consciousness and the higher states of consciousness that had been long known to the metaphysical traditions of the East, possibly because mainstream Christian teaching had concentrated on enforcing collective belief, and science was intent on discovering the laws governing the world of matter rather than exploring the nature of consciousness. This process, extending from the 16th to the 19th centuries, culminated in what was called the Enlightenment, which also signaled the waning power of the old Christian order. Reason was to replace faith, science was to replace religion, which had come to regard as little more than residual superstition. But with the waning power of the old Christian order, there was a dangerous vacuum left. One of the followers of Jung wrote this: "The breakdown of a central myth is like the shattering of a vessel containing a precious essence. The fluid is spilled and drains away, soaked up by the surrounding undifferentiated matter. Meaning is lost, and in its place, primitive and atavistic contents are reactivated. Differentiated values disappear and are replaced by the elemental motivations of power and pleasure, or else the individual is exposed to emptiness and despair." There are apparently 30 million people in Europe who are suffering from depression. And I'm sure that Peter could give us the ones for this country. So I think we can see that this has actually happened. Differentiated values have disappeared, and they've been replaced by the elemental motivations of power and pleasure. The problem, as Jung saw it, is that our conscious mind has become so detached from its instinctual matrix, that he called the unconscious, that we are unable to see the danger of the course we are on. Consciousness, thus torn from its roots, possesses a Promethean freedom, but it also partakes of a dangerous hubris. So when I come to the dragon, one of my favorite subjects, because the dragon of mythology is really an image of nature's immense power both to create and to destroy, and we carry that power within us as we are part of nature. It's also an image of the instinctual aspect of our psyche that Jung called our primordial soul. When it's split off from the conscious mind, it can burst through our fragile defenses and take possession of us. And we've seen the rise and fall of two totalitarian ideologies in the last century and are now witnessing the rise of a third. In Syria and Afghanistan, we can see what a state of possession looks like and the suffering that it engenders. You can see here that there is a hero trying to stab this enormous dragon and not getting very far. And this is really what Christianity tried to do in repressing the instinct. It tried to get rid of it by stabbing the dragon, so to speak. But it got nowhere with that, as I'll explain. The true battle of the hero is to free ourselves from being possessed by this unconscious aspect of our psyche, to recognize, confront, and transform its power to control us, so it can't take us over. I love this picture. It's no good trying to kill the dragon. We have to learn how to relate to its power, to become conscious of when it's taking us over in the form of rage, hatred, fear, lust, or whatever other examples that anybody here would like to think about. Then we may receive the treasure that it guards, and all the mythology about the dragon speaks of the treasure that the dragon guards. And that treasure is the gold of a transformed consciousness and the power to act in the world with compassion without causing harm or giving rise to evil. Believing that matter is something insensate and dead has allowed us to split the atom and develop a dangerous technology which is leaving lethal residues of radioactivity on the Earth from nuclear explosions and also from nuclear reactors because of the residue that they leave behind. It is also driving us to create ever more demonic weapons with which to destroy our enemies and perpetuate our addiction to war. But the real enemy lies within, in the part of our nature whose presence and power we have ignored. This whole situation is reflected in this 20th century picture of the Cyclops by Odilon Redon, where a one-eyed giant gazes out over a beautiful landscape holding the figure of a naked woman. It illustrates to me the current dissociation of our rational mind from the deeper matrix of our soul and its different way of knowing. Taken as a whole, world culture is now enthralled to this one-eyed consciousness. Technological progress, scientific advance, the acquisition of wealth and political power have become the supreme goals, and the human mind has virtually replaced God and no longer recognizes a dimension of reality beyond the physical universe, nor any form of consciousness transcendent to its own. We're living now at the end of a great trajectory which has brought about the gradual separation or differentiation of our human species from nature, and the development of self-awareness and everything we now define as human consciousness. But in the process, we've lost touch with the soul and the ancient sense of participation in a, in a sacred cosmos. This story has been described by Richard Tarnas as a heroic ascent to autonomy, but at the same time a tragic fall from unity. Yet now we are in the midst of a great awakening of the soul, one that could see the marriage of the masculine and feminine principles and the long separated aspects of our psyche. This marriage is prefigured in this 15th century painting of the Coronation of the Virgin. For centuries, a tremendous problem has been troubling the waters of the soul. And here I would ask all the men present to forgive me for being rather sharp. I don't mean to be aggressive about this. It's really an appeal to men as well as women. The problem is this: in a civilization which is patriarchal in organization and outlook, which has been structured for several millennia by a male image of God, presiding over religions and institutions created entirely by men, and by a polarizing mythology which glorifies power, conquest, and the domination of nature, how can the long silenced voice of the soul be heard? How can we hear it or pay attention to it? How can we realize that matter and the phenomenal world are a living expression of spirit, and that how we treat nature has an effect on the web of life which embraces us all? In the alchemical tradition, there are many images like this one which show the killing of a king. So who is this king? He stands for our inflated, dissociated ego consciousness, the incomplete and inadequate view of reality we have built up, and our infatuation with the rational mind. The old king has to die before a new vision of reality can come into being. But as the alchemist said, killing the king is no easy matter. Alchemy and Kabbalah kept alive the ancient image of the sacred marriage between the two great archetypal principles that were symbolized by the king and the queen. Here is a beautiful image of the alchemical wedding representing the union of the two long separated aspects of our psyche. The king representing the transformed mind and the queen, the awakened and recognized soul. These have been brought into being by an arduous process of the transformation of consciousness known as the Great Work in alchemy. Note that the dragon hasn't been left out of the picture, and the star over their joined heads represents what I call stellar consciousness that I will return to at the end of my talk. So the alchemists and all the metaphysical traditions knew that within manifest life there is a hidden reality of the highest order. And what has been lost to our culture is the awareness that the cosmos has a soul, and that this cosmic soul, intelligence, or consciousness is the origin and ground of our own individual soul, our own consciousness. To understand the idea of the soul as a cosmic reality and the nature of our own individual soul, we need to broaden our concept of it to embrace the inner life of the universe and recognize that it is alive, conscious, and the eternal ground of our own consciousness. As Ravi has said, and I've got it written down here, the metaphysical traditions of both East and West have long taught that we are living within subtle fields of reality, which are imperceptible to our normal level of consciousness and the instruments so far devised by science. They tell us that our lives are woven into a cosmic tapestry whose threads connect us not only with many dimensions of reality, but with multitudes of beings inhabiting those dimensions. Beyond the present confines of our sight, a limitless field of consciousness interacts with our own. These traditions tell us that a great nested chain of being emanates from the ineffable light source of the divine ground to our world, which is the densest vibrational level of physical manifestation. So here's a modern drawing of this soul presence. It's actually drawn by my husband, but I think it's one of the most beautiful things that he's done. So I'm going to attempt, and I say attempt, a definition of the soul as I see it. The soul is the cosmic sea of being underlying physical reality through which all things are connected to each other. You can call it a web instead of a sea if you like. The soul is the source or matrix of consciousness. It's both in us and we are in it, and the subtle body that we carry and that we inhabit after our death is one aspect of this. What we call our heart, our deepest instinctual feelings and longings, carries the voice of the soul and is the principal medium of our connection to it. The physical body and the brain is the vehicle of the soul in this dimension of reality. And in the words of Heraclitus, you could not discover the limits of the soul, even if you traveled by every path in order to do so. So profound is its meaning. Now, I've quoted from Ravi because one of my favorite books is Science and the Sacred. And this is what he says. The one central insight into truth to which all Indian wisdom points is the oneness of all that exists. This insight is not alien to other cultures, but in India, all the great sages again and again return to it. Although the truth is easily stated as all is one, the sages have also said that the realization of this truth in the core of one's being can take many lifetimes. And the realization of this truth is held to be the purpose of human existence. All art, philosophy, and science, if they are true, reflect this vision and further its realization. So thank you for that, Ravi. But how are we one? We are one, in my view, through the divinity which pervades all forms of life. So I brought here this wonderful quote from a 16th century Kabbalist. The essence of divinity is found in every single thing. Nothing but it exists. Do not attribute duality to God. Let God be solely God. Do not say this is a stone and not God. God forbid. Rather, all existence is God, and the stone is a thing pervaded by divinity. So the Buddha, like Christ, holds the image of our own innate and unrecognized divinity, our unrealized evolutionary potential. Each is also an image of the self, the guiding consciousness within the evolutionary process and within ourselves in our deepest nature. In India for millennia, the practice of Kundalini Yoga and other practices has offered a method of enabling our still limited consciousness to evolve to higher or deeper levels of perception and the experience of invisible worlds or levels of reality which are embraced by the word enlightenment. Alchemy and Kabbalah in the West correspond to Kundalini Yoga and the other disciplines in the East. These ancient traditions teach that contemplation and specific meditative exercises prepare the soul for communion with transcendent dimensions and for holding awareness of those planes of reality while living in a physical body. This experience is summed up by these words of a woman who sent them to me about a week ago, who has had this Kundalini awakening. Spontaneous, not tried for, just spontaneous. Everything was now lit by an inner beauty surpassing everything I had experienced before. Every face was my own, every leaf or bloom an aspect of my being. I felt that I had at last fused all living levels. I knew finally and incontrovertibly that spirit and flesh are one, matter and the transcendent but differing faces of a single essence. Now in dreams, the call to move beyond our present understanding of reality or relate to the deeper dimension of our nature can manifest as a bridge. And I love this picture of a bridge which I found on the internet. I think we need to build a bridge between the two ways of knowing that I mentioned that we carry within us, the lunar way and the solar way. If we go on at only the solar way, we've had it as a species. We've simply got to connect with the depths and the depths of nature within us. We could also build a bridge between physics and metaphysics, between this reality and another transrational one. In a book that he wrote with Jung, the physicist Wolfgang Pauli said that the only acceptable point of view appears to be the one that recognizes both sides of reality, the quantitative and the qualitative, the physical and the psychical, as compatible with each other, and can embrace them both simultaneously. If we could build this bridge, drawing on what the near-death experience is teaching us and what Peter has told us about the end-of-life experience, we could also understand that with death, it is only the physical body that dies. Coming to the end now. The great images of the Christian myth, like the Annunciation and the divine birth, are archetypal realities that can come alive again in our era. I think that at the present time, an arduous process of annunciation and birth is taking place in the collective soul of humanity. Have any of you heard of an organization called Abbas? Well, that has 30 million followers now, and it is really trying to address the problems of the whole world. So that kind of thing is an example of this annunciation and birth. A new cosmology is being born, a new vision of our profound relationship with a conscious, intelligent universe, and a new consensus growing among a number of physicists, astrophysicists, and cosmologists that cosmic consciousness and not matter is the primary ground of reality and our own consciousness. This emerging paradigm, together with the strengthening voice of the environmental movement, gives us hope that we may rescue this planet from our predatory and exploitive habits of behavior and our outworn beliefs in time to counteract the danger of destroying not only millions of more species, but our own as well. And it invites us to recognize that we have a role to play in the service of the planet and ultimately the cosmos, to know ourselves in our innermost nature as cosmic beings, incarnated here for a purpose and aware of our fundamental unity. Every metaphysical tradition says that we belong to two worlds or dimensions of reality, and that we need to relate to both. And it teaches that the eye of the heart opens slowly to awareness of this extraordinary realization. This is what I've called the sacred marriage and stellar consciousness, or conscious participation in an ensouled universe. And I found in the book on the garden here this beautiful quote from Tagore to end with: harmony with all things arouses a desire to seek our freedom, not in the man-made world, but in the depth of the universe, and makes us offer our reverence to the divinity inherent in fire, water, and trees. I thought that was just beautiful. I found it last night. So thank you very much. It's a lot to take in, but I can explain things further if you like.